What's up, Lakewood? All over the world. Thank you for tuning in tonight to Lakewood Church. I am so grateful to be opening God's Word in your presence wherever you are, on the couch, on the way home from work, running errands, at the bank, wherever this night finds you. I am so thankful to be sharing this Word. And this is the last Wednesday of 2020. And so it's a privilege to bring you this last word for 2020. And I want to start talking about this next year. I know that there's a little bit of time left on the calendar, but my mind is already in 2021 because I am anticipating all that God is going to do in the new year. If it is true that God takes us from glory to glory, and from faith to faith, I know that this next year, this next season is going to be God's very best. As Pastor Joel said, best is next. And I am excited about it. I wonder if you would right now, if you're driving, don't close your eyes. But I'm going to pray and I'm going to bless this word and those that hear it tonight. Lord, we pray right now in Jesus' name. That you would anoint me to declare your word, that there would be no distractions, that there would be a clear focus and intention, that you would speak to the hearts of your people. I pray that we would be encouraged tonight. I pray that we would be uplifted and inspired to continue to move in your direction as you faithfully move in ours. God, I pray that you would give us a mindset and a perspective that we need for the season and the year that is to come. We ask this in Jesus' name. And the church typed in the comment section, amen. Come on, throw some amens in the comment section. Like I mentioned already, I've already been thinking about 2021. And this is pretty typical for me, for my family, my wife and I. We always choose a word for the year. If I go back a few years, the word was produce. I think that was 2018, the word was produce. 2019, my word was build. And 2020, the word was discipline. And I tried to orient my life and my focus around this singular idea. So I've been thinking about my word for 2021, and I think that word is progress, progress. And as I've been thinking about it and I've been praying about how I want to approach 2021, I want to make some progress. I know that it's not always going to be perfect. I know that I'm not always going to be the guy that's responding with the best attitude, with the best words, with the best reactions. But I want to be able to measure my progress over the course of this year. The thing about progress, though, is progress is a process. Progress is a process. And so tonight, I'm going to talk to you about progress is a process. As we look at the opening words of Scripture in the book of Genesis, we see the formation of everything that we see and experience in the world today. God creates the cosmos, the universe, the grass, the lilies, the birds, the oceans, the mountains. And He does it all piece by piece, day by day, one phase and stage at a time. The interesting thing to note immediately here is that our God is all powerful. He can speak worlds into existence. He has the ability to change things in an instant. And yet, on the onset of time, we see that He takes His time to create the world and the universe. The Bible says that the creative process was 6 days, and on the seventh day, He rested. But we also know that in the mind of God, there really is no time limit. There are no time restraints. God stands outside of time and looks at it as an object in front of Him. And so he could have spoken the word and the oceans and the mountains and the lilies and the trees would all rise up and be created with one breath. And yet, he takes his time to create on day one. And then day one ends. It is evening and it is morning, and he creates on day two. And he closes the day and it's evening and it's morning and it's day three. And he continues this process. He establishes this model for his coming creation in humanity, that when God does things, he does them within the context of a process. He does it with a pace. God was not in a hurry to create the world. Some theologians speculate that maybe perhaps a day in the mind of God is 100 years. 1,000 years. We really don't know. But what we do know is that God took his time. And if God is not in a hurry, we shouldn't be either. He establishes a pace. He establishes a process. Because he wanted to give us his pattern for progress. That it would not happen overnight, but that it would happen over time through process, because progress is a process. Now, this is a major struggle for me, guys, if I'm being completely honest. You hear people say patience is a virtue, and I believe that because it's scriptural. But I also believe that hustle is a virtue. I believe in getting up, get going, and start executing. I've got goals for 2021 that I'm mapping out, and I plan on reaching those goals in this year. The problem is, I typically like to get ahead of myself, and I'm thinking I need to accomplish some things and execute some things in a timetable that is moving more quickly than perhaps what has been established by God. And that creates frustration. I don't know if you've ever felt like this. Like maybe you're not in the place in your life that you thought you would be by now. That you're not in the stage of life that you thought you would be by now. You thought some other things would be happening by this point. Well, let me tell you something. Progress is a process. There is a pattern for destiny. In the scripture, we find that Jesus performs 34 miracles that are recorded. 34 miracles recorded in the New Testament. Now, we know through further study that Jesus performed far more miracles than just the 34 that we read about. As a matter of fact, John writes in John 21, if every miracle was written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not have room for the books that would be written. Jesus did a lot. He accomplished a lot. He fulfilled a lot. He executed at a tremendous level. And yet, we never read of Jesus being in a hurry. We never read that Jesus rushed from one place to the next. We never read that he missed his iCal appointment and needed to move some things around and skip to the next thing on his agenda and on his schedule. He moved at his own pace, the pace of purpose. When he was on his way to resurrect a girl who had died, he had time for the woman who had been struggling with an issue of blood for 12 years. He stopped. He turned around. The woman was healed. He had a conversation with her. And then he went about his way. Wasn't in a hurry. He told his mother, for his first miracle, that it wasn't even time for the first miracle. He was so settled into his pace and into the timetable that God had established for him to fulfill his purpose in the earth that he wasn't even in a hurry to do his first miracle. Wasn't in a hurry. The process of the first miracle was something to be studied. Turning the water into wine at this particular wedding in the New Testament. He could have created wine literally out of thin air. He could have had vessels of his choice, the most amazing vessels that were ever crafted by human hands at that time, just show up in that wedding hall on that day. And yet he had some people go get some vessels, take them down to where they get water, put some water in them, bring them back, set them up, and then he turns the water into wine. But he did it not in an instant, but through a process. Let me ask you this question. Who is setting your pace? You or God? Who is establishing the goals that you want to reach in 2021? You, through the things you want to conquer in your own strength? Or are you allowing God to direct you in the things that are to be accomplished in this new year? Who is establishing your timeline for things that you think should be happening right now? You or God? Are you feeling overcome already with pressure? Pressure to change, pressure to succeed, pressure to be at a certain place in your life right now. Can I ask you, who is applying the pressure? You and the expectations that you have created, or God? Is it possible that you are placing pressure on yourself because you have established a timeline and an expectation that you and God have not agreed upon? As we look into the Old Testament in the book of Exodus, moving to chapter 23 and verse 29, the Bible is sharing with us God's process for his people, the Israelites, to inhabit what God has purposed for them in the promised land of Canaan. And the scripture says, I will not drive them out. This is God speaking to Moses, giving him context for what's about to happen in the next season of his life as he leads the people of God. I will not drive them out, speaking of Israelites' enemies, from before you in 1 year, or the land would become desolate and the wild animals would multiply against you. I love this verse in verse 30. Little by little, I will drive them out from before you until you have increased and possess the land. I will drive them out from before you in 1 year. Little by little, I will drive them out. God does things little by little. He changes things incrementally. He is not in a hurry because good things take time. You see, God was making sure that the pace of his people was the right tempo and the right cadence. Because if they would have stepped into the promised land, the promise would have multiplied against them. And the thing that was meant to be enjoyed and the thing that was meant for them to walk in would be the thing that crushed them. The worst thing that can happen for us as believers is to get the right things at the wrong time. Sometimes God's delays are actually his mercy. Sometimes God's pace that we feel is too slow and we're struggling with the timing and we want to know why things aren't happening, but there's actually provision and protection in the delay. Because if you got what you wanted too early, and if you got the good thing that God had for you at the wrong time, it would be the wrong thing. And that thing that was meant to bless you would be the thing that crushed you. So we have to trust God and trust his timing, that he knows what he is doing and he knows the season in which to do it. This is what I've found just in my short time in following Jesus, is that if we allow God to do it slowly, he will do it effectively. If we let him do it, it will be done right. If we let him build the platform, it will never fall. If we let him develop character within us, then we can handle the storms that come around us. It can't happen all at once because we wouldn't be able to handle it. But if we allow God to do it slowly, he will do it effectively. As we journey through the Old Testament, we step into Numbers 33. And Numbers 33 is running parallel with what we read in Exodus 23. Numbers 33 is giving us an account of how God brought the people into the Promised Land. It says that these are the stages by which the Israelites went out of the land of Egypt. I even love how in my Bible, this is the New Revised Standard Version right here, even the title for the chapter preaches a little bit. It says, the stages of Israel's journey from Egypt. These are the stages. Verse 2 says, Moses wrote down their starting points, stage by stage. See, what I have discovered is that purpose isn't fulfilled in seconds. It's fulfilled in stages. That promises don't happen in seconds. They happen in stages. Progress doesn't happen in seconds. It happens in stages. And the greatest thing that we can learn for 2021 is that we have to allow God to set the stage. Allow God to set the stage for your promotion. Allow God to set the stage for your relationships. Allow God to set the stage for your advancement and the things that you want to accomplish. Because if we set the stage, we are going to sabotage the stage. But if we let God set the stage, we will see him fulfill things that we couldn't fulfill in the height of our strength and our effort. Let God set the stage, because progress doesn't happen in seconds. It happens in stages. Ecclesiastes says, for there is a right time and a procedure to every purpose. I love that word procedure. It's almost a scientific word. There is a procedure to it. There is a precision to it. There is a calculated way that God is orchestrating the events of your life to fulfill the things that he has purposed for you and from you. But we have to allow God to set the stage. You don't have to manipulate people if God is setting the stage. You don't have to spend more money than you have if you let God set the stage. You don't have to worry about how it's all going to work out in the future if you let God set the stage. For he has a time and a purpose for everything under heaven. Let God set the stage. The right thing at the wrong time is the wrong thing. We make fun of people who set up Christmas trees in July. It's a beautiful thing. In December, we take pictures around the Christmas tree. We put lights on the Christmas tree. We put presents under the Christmas tree. It's amazing. It's beautiful. It's the most wonderful time. But if it's July, we're making fun of you on Instagram. That's happening. It's the right thing, but it's in the wrong season. And so many of us have disqualified ourselves from operating to the full extent of our potential in the season that we're in right now because we think we have to have things that are not required of us in this season. What you have right now is what you need right now to fulfill what God is calling you to do right now. Don't pull the Christmas tree out of the closet in July. It's not the right thing at the right time. Make sure that you're doing things in the right season. You don't have to live with all this weight, with all these expectations, with all this pressure that you're putting on yourself. You're going to have what you need when you need it if you let God set the stage. In Numbers 33, it lays out the progress that the Israelites made moving toward the promised land. It says they set out from Ramses and camped in Succoth. They set out from Succoth and camped in Etham. They set out from Etham and camped in another place. They set out, these are words that I can't pronounce. They set out from the Red Sea and camped in the wilderness of Sin. They set out from the wilderness of Sin and camped in another place. Let me just fast forward a little bit for you. Over 40 verses record the Israelites setting out, moving forward, moving on. They set up camp. They fulfilled their time there. They woke up the next morning and they kept moving. Let me tell you what happens on January 1st. You wake up and you keep moving. Even if the day is rough, even if the first day of the year doesn't all happen like you think it should happen, let God set the stage. You have to keep setting out. 40 times they set out toward the promise. What I'm trying to tell you is movement is our responsibility. Fulfillment is God's responsibility. You keep moving. You keep getting up every day, putting your feet on the floor, putting your shoulders back, and declaring that you are a child of God, that God is working all things together for the good of those that love Him and are called according to His purpose in His season and in His timing. Keep moving. Don't get stuck in a mistake from 2011. Move on from the hurt in 2014. Move beyond the relationship that was broken and fractured in 2017. Move beyond the bankruptcy in 2019. Because if you keep moving, you are going to see the promises of God fulfilled in your life. Let God set the stage. Keep moving because progress is a process. But movement actually doesn't start in just our physical actions. Movement starts in our mind. If we are going to step into everything that God has for us in 2021, the movement starts in our mind. It starts with the right thinking. We're moving through fear and beyond it. We're moving through disappointment and beyond it. We're moving through our insecurities and beyond them. We have to do it in our minds first, that the work of the Spirit would happen in our minds. There is so much scripture about keeping your mind fixed on Jesus, not distracted by the things of the world, not stuck in the successes or the failures of the past, but to keep your mind moving in the direction of God. Before it is an action, it's a thought. You have to think about it first. Your thoughts set your intentions. And this next year, I'm going to be going to the gym a little bit, a little by little. You're going to see me get some pectoralis majors, little by little. Some bicepitis, little by little. It's going to take time. But before I ever walk through the gym doors, I'm going to have the thought that I want to improve my health. And then once I have the thought, I'm going to write the thought down because I'm going to make the vision plain and I'm going to make it measurable. Once I have had the thought, I've written it down, it's so much easier to execute the action. We will never do the things that we're not already thinking about. The greatest gift that you can give yourself in 2021 is awareness of what God wants to do through you and in you. So you're going to have to think about wanting to spend more time with your kids before you actually do it. You're going to have to think about fortifying some of your friendships before you actually do it. You're going to have to think about your diet before you actually do it. There's going to have to be some thought investment, and your actions will follow your thinking. It starts as a thought, and then we execute it in action. That creates movement, and movement creates momentum. Movement creates momentum. If you're going to have some progress, you're going to have to get some momentum in the process. I was out on a music tour with a Christian band called Casting Crowns and an artist named Matthew West. And this was several years ago. I was about 25 years old. And some of you are like, wow, you look 25. It's just a nice lotion. It's a skincare routine. You don't care about it. But I was out on tour with Matthew and with Casting Crowns, and we were nearing the end of the tour, and we always do something cool together. Sometimes it's laser tag in an arena. Sometimes it's an athletic competition. And in this particular scenario, we were playing wiffle ball, okay? So we're in this arena and we set up the wiffle ball course, and dude, I'm telling you, it's me and the guys in my band. We're all like early 20s, but we are getting smoked by all these, I'm gonna say this with respect, more seasoned individuals. They're a little bit older than us. I mean, to the point where we should absolutely be crushing them. But no. They're destroying us. Until, you know, about the sixth inning, one of our guys steps up, smacks a solid base hit, runs to first base. We're like, okay, we got one hit. Let's see what we can do. The next guy steps up, smacks it. Oh, base hit. Okay, we got a man on first and second. Another guy steps up, smacks it. Home run. Now we got three runs. All of a sudden, the whole atmosphere in the gym just starts to feel a little bit better. The arena atmosphere is just shifting, and we got a little pep in our step. Next guy gets up, smacks it. We're like, let's go! And Matthew West's dad, Joe West, a legend, absolute legend. He was on our team. He's like, fellas, I don't know if you realize it or not, but Mo is in the game. I was like, who's Mo, Pastor Joe? Oh, come on, Torn. You know who Mo is? Mo's in the game. It's like, one, two, three, four. No, it's just us. It's just us, Pastor Joe. No. You're missing it. Mo was in the game. Momentum just stepped into the game. And when momentum gets in the game changes, because momentum forces things in the right direction. If you get some momentum working against the opposition, you will see what God can actually do. And what I'm trying to tell you is by one little action, by one thought, by one idea, by one declaration, by coming to church one Sunday, by tuning in on one Wednesday night, by showing up in the morning for 5 minutes of prayer, by opening your Bible just to read one chapter, you can get some momentum going in your spiritual life, and your spiritual life will affect every other area of your life. But you got to get some momentum going. Get some momentum in your joy by waking up in the morning and saying, "This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it." Get some momentum in your peace, knowing that you serve the Prince of Peace. When a negative thought comes in, kick it out and make it obedient to the finished work of Jesus Christ. You can't have my peace. I'm getting momentum in my peace. I'm getting momentum in my prayer life. I'm getting momentum in my generosity, momentum in my devotion, momentum in my family. It's not going to be some big move. It's not going to be a family vacation. It's going to be sitting down at the dinner table with your phone off and the TV off, looking your children and your spouse in the eyes to listen to what they have to say. It's a little by little. It's a little move. It's a little pivot, but that movement creates momentum. Momentum in your ministry. It's a small thing. Don't search for the world's platforms. You can serve right here in your local church and make a global impact. Just show up 1 week to serve and see what God will do. Get some momentum. Because when the Holy Spirit begins to blow in the direction that you are moving, you'll realize that there is an ease and a grace to accomplishing the things that God has purposed for you to accomplish. One thought, one action at a time. Because progress is a process. Throughout the process, I can tell you there will be difficult times and difficult moments. Progress is not easy. There is a discipline required. There is an inner fortitude required. There is a strength required. But I suspect that you have what it takes, because all you need is all you have. Last summer, we started doing family workouts together. And it was me, Lorna, and our three little boys. We've got three little boys. You may have seen them running around or on my Instagram. Kanan, he's 7. Lawson, he's 4. And at the time, Navy was 2. And of course, you know, they come in, they got to have their shirts off. They got to have like Under Armour little sleeves and the right shoes and all the stuff if they're going to work out. Now, they're going to be lifting styrofoam weights, but it's, you got to have some momentum. So take off your shirt, you know what I'm saying? You get a little extra drive. So we're in our living room and we're doing these family exercises, you know, pretty consistently, maybe 4 or 5 nights a week. And the whole family's in there and we're doing our thing. And, you know, we're doing our little, you know what I'm saying? We got our little stretches and we're doing sit-ups and push-ups and all the ups and all the downs and all the things. And there were moments, man, where it was hard work. And of course, I had to be the family motivator. Normally, I was in the back, like, doing half of the exercises while everyone else was trying their hardest. But that's not the point. I was motivating the family. And so when we would get to, like, some of those final sets, those last few sit-ups, those last few push-ups, I'd say to the boys, I'd say, "Hey, if it's getting harder, you're getting stronger." And at first, the boys are just laughing at me like, "Dad, what are you saying?" I'm like, "Nah, man. If it's getting harder, woo, you're getting stronger. Come on, I can see it right now. I see biceps. Come on, I see abs. Let's go. If it's getting harder, you're getting stronger." And they would push just a little bit harder and go a little bit further. They would get to the end. They'd have no more gas left. And I'd be like, "Hey, this ain't over. We are Wells. And Wells don't quit. Get back up. Let's go. We are wells, and wells don't quit. If it's getting harder, you're getting stronger. Well, this happened week after week, night after night. We're doing it, and I'm just every time. That's my go-to. Those are my two phrases. Like, my kids are going to be talking about this when they're 40 years old. My dad was such a clown, dude. It's getting hard. We're getting stronger, you know? Well, fast forward a few months. We weren't doing the workouts anymore. But the boys were upstairs, and they were doing something, playing a game. And Lawson, 4 years old, got frustrated, started crying. Kanan's like, Lawson, if it's getting harder, you're getting stronger. We are wells, and wells don't quit. All of a sudden, that crying stopped. Lawson got up. I'm not making this up. I just start hearing them chant from my bedroom. I hear them upstairs. We are wells, and wells don't quit. We are wells, and wells don't quit. We are wells, and wells don't quit. If it's getting harder, we're getting stronger. And I came to tell somebody today, you may not be a wells, but you are a child of God. And if you feel like 2020 just got harder and harder, can I tell you something? You are getting stronger and stronger. And let me tell you about children of God. If it's getting harder, we're getting stronger. And if you are a child of God, children of God, don't quit. We don't stop. We keep going. We keep pushing. We keep praying. We keep giving. We keep believing because we are children of God, and children of God don't quit. I know it's midnight. I know it's difficult. I know cancer hurts. I know the disease is painful. I know the loss feels insurmountable, but can I tell you, you are a child of God, and children of God don't quit. For the race wasn't given to the swift, neither to the strong, but to those who endure till the end. Progress is a process. We are children of God, and children of God don't quit. Do not become weary in well-doing, for in due season you will reap a harvest. If you do not give up. 4 weeks into January, you may be feeling good. February, it may be getting a little harder. March, you may want to quit. You're a child of God. Don't quit. Maybe some of you've been wondering how to get in the game, how to start. Where do I start? Well, it starts with your faith in Jesus. It starts with believing that we have all fallen short of the glory of God, that we are all sinners in desperate need of the grace that is given through Jesus Christ. And if that's you listening today, I want to invite you to put your faith in Jesus. It's a belief that turns into an action that becomes a lifestyle of following Jesus every day of your life. If that's you and you want to put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, I want you to pray with me. Repeat after me. Jesus, I am a sinner in need of your grace. I believe that you died for my sins, that you're going to resurrect me again to spend eternity with you in heaven. This is my promise. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, we celebrate you. We want to come alongside you and give you resources and support. There's some information coming up on the screen. You can text NEW to the number on the screen to continue this walk with Jesus. And I can tell you this, it is a work that starts with Jesus. And the scripture says that he will complete everything that he starts. You're going to get there. You're going to make it. and we are so thankful to come alongside you. From Lakewood Church, we want to wish you a happy new year and leave you with this blessing from number 6. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord show you his favor and have mercy on you. May the Lord watch over you and give you his peace. Let's pray together. Jesus, thank you so much for your word, for your kindness, for your goodness toward us. I pray that we would continue to move forward, to walk with you into the things that you've purposed for us. Let us not get weary in well-doing, but let us wake up every morning and make the right choices one after the other as they multiply in purpose. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.